Hi, I'm Dan Meyer.
And I'm Bethany Lockhart Jansen. We have been talking recently about how do we create a culture where students' seeming mistakes are actually celebrated, this idea of wrong but brilliant. And today, our interview is with Mandy Jansen. She's the author of Rough Draft Math, Revising to Learn. Mandy, thank you so much for being here. We're thrilled to talk to you.
I'm so excited to be a part of it.
So, Mandy, can you tell us a little bit more about where kind of how this idea of rough draft math started and kind of how your thinking has evolved around this idea?
Oftentimes when we have class discussions, students are feeling like it's a performance. I have to perform how smart I am and show everybody that I have something correct. But as teachers, we want to create spaces where conversations are places where people keep learning. And so how do we create that exploratory environment? And the teachers in the study group thought it would make more sense to call it rough draft talk because students have experience with rough drafts from language arts.
This makes a ton of sense, especially in the realm of like whole class conversations, which can be some of the most stressful environments for both teachers and students. I mean, students especially. But I'm curious, we have questions that we ask in math class that are right or wrong. Sometimes they have a correct or incorrect answer. Do you have a thought about what are productive ways that teachers can work with an incorrect answer that does justice to the student and helps learning continue?
I assume that whatever someone is sharing makes sense to them right now. And before I try to think about how do I fix it or how do I correct it or make something more right, I try to decenter and put myself in the mind of the person who thought that thing. So why does this make sense to them right now? And what can we all learn from what they had to say? And rather than thinking it's my job to fix them, I think that how do we as a community keep evolving in our thinking if we assume that this idea makes sense to that person for a particular reason?
It's so true in the life, in our personal lives. Like we don't,
I
never
was
like
just
fully.
Thinking that. I was like, what if I did that with my husband? What if I what is he understanding right now about? I love that idea.
I'm a constructivist, right? Like everything we think right now makes sense to us from the series of experiences that we've had up to this point. And if I don't think differently, it's because nothing has really perturbed me to think differently. So what sort of experiences do people need to have for their thinking to shift, for something else to make sense?
That's that's a belief that you have about learning that I think that Bethany and I share to a large degree. I'm really compelled by something I heard from Rochelle Gutierrez that she said, we act our way into new beliefs. And so I can in an abstract way behind my desk here, no students around me, like say, yes, I believe that. And then get into a situation where a student says that the quantity A plus B squared is A squared plus B squared or does something else that like, yeah, that's a way that the student is thinking about math. It is not correct, but it makes sense to them. But concretely, how can you offer us some actions around incorrect answers that can help teachers act their way into this belief that really just sounds so honoring to students and their intelligence, their brilliance?
Yeah, I feel like orienting ourselves to what can we do to construct our classroom where it's a community learning together rather than the teacher being the arbiter of what's correct and incorrect. And so I think I spend more time trying to select and choose who's thinking to compare and contrast, whether it's anonymously or asking students to share. And so it's more about comparing and contrasting. What can we learn by thinking about these two ways of thinking together? And how do those ideas get combined, maybe revised together? How can we compare and contrast each other's thinking to learn more than we learned from before?
It feels also that idea of compare, contrast can be, I've seen it done in a way that is generative of this kind of positive discussion, but I've also seen it in just that simple right, wrong, right? So I'm thinking about in our classroom culture, if as a teacher, if I'm coming against that tension of, but I need my students to know that, or to select the right answer, or my goal is that at the end they get the answer right. I'm trying to think if that's a tension a teacher is experiencing, how can they, is it about just creating more space for these conversations, or how can we kind of support each other in reframing this culture to really create an environment where it's the end goal isn't just that right answer, but it is about generating those ideas.
When you can compare and contrast, you might think, oh, who's going to win? Whose solution is the right one? And it's more that we create a third response now. Like after we've seen these two that we can compare and contrast, what's the response that we would write or the explanation that we would give that's different now than either of these two? What's the new version? So moving toward a collective understanding from individual understandings.
And the wrong answer was maybe just as helpful or even more helpful at helping construct that final draft or that next draft rather of a thinking as the right one was. They both have value to add in that conversation.
And then also the notion that our thinking can continue to evolve all the time, even if it's in theory correct. So I could come up with a different representation that would help people see something differently, or I could write a more elegant justification, or I could maybe use different terminology than I used before. So that it's not about getting the correct answer, but how can we keep evolving in our thinking?
We're not done. We don't have to be, we're not, there's not this final endpoint. Oh, we got it right. We're done, right? I love that.
It's been such a treat to have Mandy Jansen in the Math Teacher Lounge with us, sharing her ideas about rough draft math. Definitely check out the book. Ideas are so powerful and so necessary right now. Thanks so much, Mandy.
And if folks want to learn more about your work or ask questions, where else can they find you?
Well, I always really get a lot out of dialogue with folks on Twitter. So my Twitter handle is @MandyMathEd.
Thank you so much. Thanks for joining us on Math Teacher Lounge.
Thanks for having me.